Hey guys, in this video I'm going to discuss with you round robin scheduling algorithm with one more numerical. See, in the last video we have taken one numerical and we have discussed round robin scheduling algorithm. In this algorithm the difference is we have taken the arrival time, the same arrival time for all the processes. Okay, next thing is, in this numerical we will also count the number of context switches and the CPU utilization. Okay, now here one extra thing which is given is the context switch time is 1 unit, fine. Now what is this context switch? See, when any process is in ready state, after that it will go to, the short term scheduler will pick that process and that process will go to the running state. CPU would be allocated to that process. And here this round robin scheduling is preempted scheduling, means when this time quantum expires, then that particular process will again go back to ready queue. This is known as preemption when the time quantum expires. Okay, now see, when suppose P1 is running and here we have P2 and P3 in ready state and P1 is running. Now suppose after the time quantum expires, P1 will go to again ready state and one another process, let us suppose P2 will go to the running state. Now what is this context switching? This change of these processes from running to ready and ready to running, that is known as context switching. And what is there in context switching? Kya hota hai in context switching? See, let us take a simple example. Let us suppose this P1 has been completed 30%, fine, when the time quantum expires. Okay, now this state of the process, that 30% of this process has been completed, this information, this data of this running process would be stored first of all. Okay, and then this process will preempt it and go to the ready state. And why so? So that when next time again CPU would be allocated to this P1, then CPU will start running this process, executing this process from this point onwards, not from the starting. That is why we save the state of the process. Okay, so some data, or you can say the CPU register values, would be stored. Okay, and that is known as, that process is known as context switching, or the context is what this data, or you can say the CPU register values, or the data that describes the process state, that is known as context. Fine. So this whole this complete funda, this phenomena is known as context switching. So this you know, saving of the state and loading of the another process from ready to running state, and loading the, you know, this state again from where the CPU will start executing this process. This phenomena will also take some time. Fine. So in this numerical, this time is given 1 unit. The context switching time is 1 unit. So let us solve this example, and now then we will find out the CPU utilization. See, arrival time of all the processes is 0. So when you are solving any numerical with the help of this round robin scheduling, we will maintain one more queue, that is ready queue. Okay. Now we will maintain one ready queue and see, at 0 all the processes are there in ready queue. You can see arrival time of all the processes is 0. So you can fill this ready queue like this: P1, P2, P3, P4 and P5. All the 5 processes are there in ready queue at time 0. Now we will draw the Gantt chart. CPU time would be started from 0. Now which process is to be assigned to this CPU? See, all the processes are having arrival time 0. Okay, maybe so we will go with the order of writing of these processes, or you can say you just go to the ready queue and delete the first process which is to be executed from this ready queue, that is P1, and assign CPU to this process. Fine. Now for how many unit of time? For only 3 unit of time, because time quantum is only 3 unit, 0 to 3. Now check out the burst time of this process. Fine. See, don't do that. P1 has been done, and then put this P1 to this this ready queue. Then again P2 and like this. You have to check the burst time also. You have to update the burst time also, because P1 has completed its execution till 3 minutes of time. So remaining burst time of this P1 is what? 8 minus 3, that is 5 units of time. So P1 will need now 5 units of time more to complete its execution. Now P1 would be stored in this ready queue again. So here in this case, no need to check while P1 was running, did any other process come or not, because all the processes has been arrived at time 0. So we need not to worry about the new incoming process, because no process will come during the execution of any process. So that is why we will put this P1 again into this ready queue simply. Okay. Now please don't do that. Next process is P2, so assign P2 to this one. Why? So because one extra thing which is given in this numerical is the context switch time is 1 unit. So here what is, when the P1 is preempted from this CPU, then the state of this P1 would be saved, and that is known as context switching, and another process is to be loaded. So that time taken due for that thing is 1 unit. So for that 1 unit of time, CPU would be idle, because here context switching is there. In the previous numericals, we didn't assume that the context switching is taking any time. So we have to, if this context switch time is given, then we have to draw this context switch time in this Gantt chart. So till 3 to 4, CPU was idle because context switching was there. None of the processes was there in this CPU. So from 3 to 4, for 1 unit of time, this is what the context switching. At 4 now, next process, check out the ready queue, next process is P2. P2 would be allocated to this CPU. For how many unit of time? For 3 unit of time. But do not write that 7 plus 3 directly 7. You have to check the burst time of that process also. P2 will need only 2 unit of time. So we will run this P2 for only 2 unit. 4 plus 2 is 6. Fine. Now you will not store this P2 back to this ready queue. Next process is to be loaded from this ready queue, that is P3. That is also known as context switching. So that also needs 1 unit of time. From 6 to 7, CPU was idle because context switching was there. Okay. Now at 7, next process will delete P3, we will locate CPU to P3 for 3 units of time. P2 got completed now. For 3 units of time, 7 plus 3 is 10. So remaining burst time of this process is 7 minus 3 is 4. P3 still needs 4 unit of time. So we'll store this P3 back to, we'll put this P3 back to ready queue. Okay, because it's not completed till now. So here, one more context switching is there. And for 1 unit of time, CPU was idle, 10 to 11. We'll store P3 back to this. Again, put the P3 into this ready queue. Now, next process to be executed is P4. P4 for how many unit of time? For 3 unit of time. 11 plus 3 is 14. But it needs only 3 unit of time. So that is why we will not again put this into this ready queue, because this got completed. Fine. Now, next P5 would be loaded, and that is also context switching time. So the time for context switching is 1 unit. So 14 to 15 CPU was, from 14 to 15 CPU was idle. Now next is P5. Allocate CPU to P5 for 3 unit of time. 15 plus 3, because time quantum is 3 unit. 15 plus 3 is 18. Now update this time. 5 minus 3 is 2. It still needs 2 unit of time. That is why we put again P5 into this ready queue, and next process to be executed from ready queue and allocate CPU to that process, and this is known as context switching. So for 1 unit of time, CPU was idle doing context switching, 18 to 19. Okay, now at 19, P1, next process is P1, CPU would be allocated to P1. It needs 5 units of time, but we cannot allocate CPU for 5 unit of time to P1 because time quantum is only 3 units. So 19 plus 3 is only 22. So the updated time, so updated burst time, the remaining burst time for this P1 is now 5 minus 3 is 2. It still needs 2 unit of time. Fine. Here again context switching would be there for 1 unit of time, that is 22 to 23. Next process. Yeah, one more thing is P1 would be again stored into this, put into this ready queue. Now next is P3. CPU would be allocated to P3 for 3 unit of time. 23 plus 3 is 26. So for P3, it needs 4 unit of time. So the remaining time is 4 minus 3 is 1. It still needs 1 unit of time to, for completing its execution. That is why we again put P3 into this ready queue. Fine, and P5 would be loaded into the CPU. So this is known as, here again context switching would be there for 1 unit of time, 26 to 27. Next is P5. See, the burst time requirement of P5 is only 2 unit of time. So that is why we run P5 for only 2 unit, not for 3 unit. 27 plus 2 is 29. Now P5 got completed. 0 unit of time requirement. That is why we will not put this P5 into this queue. We will only load the next process. So here context switching would be there. 1 unit of time, 29 to 30. Now CPU would be allocated to P1. Remaining time for this P1 is only 2 unit. 30 plus 2 is 32. Now this also got completed. Will not put this into this ready queue. Now P3 would be loaded. The state of P3 would be again loaded. So this is context switching. Again it will take 1 unit of time. CPU is idle for this time to 32 to 33. Now last one is P3, and it will take, it requirement is only 1 unit of time. That is why we run this process for only 33 to 34. Now ready queue is empty, no process is there to execute. That is why this is the signal that you can store the round robin scheduling algorithm. So this is the Gantt chart considering the context switch time. Fine. Now see, find out the completion time, turnaround time and waiting time. Check out completion time. At what time processes has been completed its execution? For P1, what is the completion time? Okay, check out for completion time, check out from this side. See, here we got P1. So the completion time for P1 is, at what time P1 has completed its execution? At time 30. Okay, we will not take 33, we will not take 30, we will take this 32, this one. So here completion time is 32. For P2, see, for P2 completion time is 6. For P3 completion time is 34. For P4 completion time is 14. For P5 completion time is 29. Fine. Now turnaround time. Turnaround time would be completion time minus arrival time. Completion time minus arrival time. Arrival time for each process is 0. That is why completion time and arrival time would be same. 32, 6, 34, 14 and 29. Now what is waiting time? Waiting time would be what? Turnaround time minus burst time. Turnaround time is 32, burst time. Burst time will take the original burst time. That is 8. 32 minus 8. Fine. So here will write what? 24. 6 minus 2, 4. 34 minus 7, 27. 14 minus 3, that is 11. 29 minus 5. Here will write 24. Okay. Now response time is what? Check out the Gantt chart. At what time CPU was allocated very first time to P1? At time 0 only, and arrival time is 0 only, so response time for this is 0. Response time for P2. At what time? See, P2 is here, very first time CPU was allocated to P2 at time 4, not at time 3, because from 3 to 4 CPU was idle. So we will take this time 4. and arrival time for P2 is what? 0, 4 minus 0, response time is 4. For P3, 7 minus 0, that is 7. For P4, 11 minus 0, that is 11. For P5, 15 minus 0, that is 15. This is the response time. So, if you want to calculate the average, then you can do the total and divide by the total number of processes. I think you can do it. We will now calculate the number of context switches. See, how many number of context switches are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay. So, number of context switches is equal to 9. And now, what is CPU utilization? The formula for calculating CPU utilization is expected divided by actual. Okay. Now, actual time is what? Expected time divided by actual time. So, actual time you can check out from this Gantt chart. This schedule is from 0 to 34. So, actual time is 34 and expected CPU time is what? Expected CPU time is total of this burst time, because burst time is this na. So, in starting also we know that CPU would be busy for these unit of time, 8 plus 2 plus 7 plus 3 plus 5. So, this total is what? 17, 20 and 25. This total is 25. So, expected CPU time was 25, but actual time taken is 34. Why? So, because of this context switching. During this context switching, 9 context switches are there. So, time is 9 unit. So, 25 plus 9, I guess 34. Because of this context switching, the actual CPU utilization, the actual CPU time is 34. So, for CPU utilization, you can do 25 divided by 34 into 100. So, the answer would be approximately 73.5. CPU utilization is approximately 73.5%. Okay. So, this is how you will solve the numerical if the context switch time is also there, and how to calculate the context switches, how to draw the Gantt chart and context switch is also there. Okay. So, as we have discussed the one numerical on this round robin scheduling algorithm. So, I guess now you can easily understand the flow chart of this round robin algorithm or working of this algorithm. See, where processes are there in ready queue. When we pick one process from the ready queue, at that time, see, we have burst time of that process as well as we have one criteria, that is the time quantum of the process. Round robin scheduling is working on the time quantum criteria. Fine. So, we will check the burst time of the process is less than the time quantum. See, suppose time quantum is 3 and one process P1 is there and the burst time of that process is only 2 unit of time. Then what happened? We do not execute that process for 3 unit of time. We execute that process only for 2 unit of time. That is why if burst time is less than time quantum, yes, if this is the condition, then execute that process till its completion. We will execute that process P1 up to 2 unit of time. After that, that process will be terminated. Fine, this is the one condition. Second condition is, suppose time quantum is 3 and one process is P2 whose burst time is 3. In that case, what will happen? Say this condition is not true because burst time is less than time quantum. No, 3 is less than 3. No, that is not true. That is why we will go to this route. Now execute the process for that specified time quantum. Time quantum is 3. Fine. We'll execute this P2 till 3 unit of time. Now it requires only 3 unit of time. So P2 got completed. P2 will not go to ready state. After that, we again check after the time quantum expires. After the time quantum expires, one condition is there. Has the process completed its execution? If yes, see, in this case, yes, P2 has completed its execution at the time quantum expires. Fine. So yes, here P2 is 3, time quantum is also 3. So has process completed its execution at the time when time quantum expires? Yes. Then the process will go to terminated state, not go to ready state. One condition is there. Maybe one process is P3 is there having burst time 3. In that case, burst time less than TQ? No, we'll go to this route. Execute that process for specified time quantum. Time quantum is 3. Still, it needs 2 unit of time. Then again, when time quantum expires, then this condition will be checked. Has the process completed its execution? No. P3 still needs 2 unit of time. In that case, what will happen? If no, then that process will again go to the ready queue, and the same process would be repeated again and again till the what is the condition to stop this round robin algorithm. When the ready queue is empty, then we'll stop this algorithm. So this is what the, you can say, flowchart of this round robin scheduling algorithm. Fine. Now we will summarize some advantages and drawbacks of this algorithm. Okay, so here are some advantages and drawbacks of round robin scheduling algorithm. See, first of all, this round robin scheduling algorithm is the most frequently used algorithm, fine, in the operating systems. It is implementable. Like we have discussed, the shortest of first scheduling algorithm is not implementable, and this is also known as time slicing algorithm, scheduling algorithm, fine. Another advantage of this algorithm is it is easy and simple to implement. Next is what? See, in this case, each process, because we have the funda of time quantum, fine, so each process gets a fair share of the CPU, fine, and that is why no starvation problem is there in this algorithm, and no convoy effect is there in this algorithm, fine. Next is, it gives the deterministic response time, or you can say the response time would be minimum in this case, because we have some criteria of that time quantum. And next is, priority is same for each processes in this kind of algorithm. And drawback of this algorithm is what? See, in this case, the main role is of time quantum. Throughput always depends on the time quantum. If the time quantum is, size of the time quantum is small, if you are taking time quantum for 1 unit of time, or you can say 1 millisecond, in that case, what will happen? You can say response time would be better. Fine, if the time quantum is very less, but see, now what the problem is, number of context switching will increase. That is why more overhead would be there, and in that case, if this is the case, then the average waiting time would also increase. And if the time quantum is, we are taking time quantum is very large, in that case, what would happen? It would be same as first come first serve scheduling algorithm, fine. So that deciding the time quantum, the size of time quantum for good performance of this scheduling algorithm is very tough. Okay, so these are some drawbacks of this algorithm, and these are some advantages of this round robin scheduling algorithm. So I'll see in the next video. Till then, bye bye, take care.